This is an extract from the Leader podcast by The Evening Standard, hosted by me, David Marsland. To hear the whole thing, search for us on your podcast provider. The amount of money owed by the government has smashed through the 2 trillion mark for the first time. It was broken last month when the Treasury borrowed a further £62.7 billion to support the economy with emergency measures like the furlough scheme. The Evening Standard's Jonathan Prinz with me now. And Jonathan, clearly coronavirus has a lot to answer for here, but is it solely to blame?
Well, it's been in a way, it's been 10 years in the making, because the government was forced to take on a lot of debt to bail out the banks in the 2009 financial crisis. And although, thanks to the austerity measures that were introduced after that, debt sort of was rising more slowly after that, it's now suddenly taken off again in a totally unprecedented way. From the sheer vast cost of having to nurse the economy through this remarkable sort of shutdown that we've had since March, which we're now emerging from, but had a profound impact on the economy.
So it's around about £30,000 for every man, woman, and child in the UK, according to your reporting, Jonathan. What does that mean for those men, women, and children? What does it matter that the government is this much in debt?
It matters on a number of levels. I mean, in the long run, the debt's got to be paid off by you and me, or by our children and probably our grandchildren, through our taxes, which is the only real source, is the only source that the debt can be repaid ultimately. It's the labours of the likes of you and I, and anyone else who works in the economy and is paying taxes. But I mean, we can cope with that because interest rates are very low at the moment, at historic low levels. So the interest rate burden on this debt is fortunately not too high. I think the worry is, you know, interest rates go up and down, and if they do go up substantially, as with a mortgage or any form of debt, the cost of servicing that debt is going to become very burdensome. And obviously, the higher it goes up, the more we're paying in interest as a country, and the less we can then afford to pay for hospitals and education and defence and transport and all that other stuff that we really want our taxes to go on.
And the Transport Secretary, Grant Shapps, has been saying that the government's effectively been put on a war footing by coronavirus, and that's just costing a lot of money. Apparently, the government debt's now larger than the entire annual output for the UK for the first time since 1961, when it was coming down in the wake of the Second World War.
That's right. I mean, you know, if you look at the chart of government debt over the last century or so, there are two enormous spikes that coincide with the First World War and the Second World War, when the government was obviously forced to pay for the planes, tanks, soldiers, etc., that were needed to wage those two wars. On each occasion, debt then came down in the peace that followed those two wars. And now you've almost got a third spike. It's not quite on the same scale yet. We're at 100%, whereas I think in the two world wars, debt went up to more than 200% of GDP. But we're heading in that direction. And I think that's the point he's making, that the government has had to wheel out absolute emergency measures that are on the scale, the scale of them is equivalent to mobilizing the nation for war. You know, that dwarfs what we saw in the financial crisis a decade or so ago. I think that's the analogy he's making. How long that is sustainable for, goodness only knows, and how we're going to pay for it through taxes in future remains to be seen. But it will have to be paid back at some point, and Rishi Sunak made that very clear today.
Among, actually, those emergency measures was one of Rishi Sunak's, which was the Eat Out to Help Out scheme. Now, apparently that's been so successful at bringing people back to restaurants that some restaurants are going to continue it.
Yeah, it's been probably of all the package of measures, it's probably the one that has caught the public imagination the most. And why not? Everyone likes something for nothing, especially when it's from the state, and especially when it's something as pleasurable as a nice meal out. So yeah, it's been a huge success. It's been tens of millions of meals that have been funded by or part funded by this scheme. The restaurant sector absolutely loves it. I mean, the point is, it's got people into the habit of eating out again, and it's enabled people to go out and get back into that habit. But the scheme ends at the end of August, and the sector's worried that people will stop going out. So a lot of restaurants, particularly in London, are carrying on with the scheme just to keep that momentum going into the autumn. There are a lot of worries about the autumn because the furlough scheme ends in October. There are big rent payments due towards the end of September. So I think they feel that anything that can keep that momentum of people coming out, revenue coming in to restaurants, has got to be a good thing. So many are continuing the scheme, but funding it themselves.
So the restaurant sector is starting to see something that might lead to some success. And there's also, after lots of bad news in retail, things are looking a little bit rosier there too.
Yeah, there were surprisingly strong retail figures today from the Office of National Statistics, which actually suggests that the volumes of sales are back above pre-pandemic levels, which is a remarkable achievement, really. I think that blanket figure hides a lot of sort of variation between sectors and between regions. And we know that London is suffering worse than most of the rest of the country because of the lack of commuters and tourists and so on. But nonetheless, it's a very encouraging sign. And hopefully other sectors will follow. And as we go into the autumn, we will start to see a sustained economic recovery.